Stephanie Warner, who will try to end the stigma on mental health. But the only way you can do that is to listen to Moments of Clarity Friday at noon on WTAN 1340 AM, the Tan Talk Radio Network.
This is the Tan Talk Radio Network.
Hey, good morning, and welcome to Freedom Works, the Paul Molloy Show. I am Paul Molloy, and this morning, along with my buddy, Matt Solomon.
Hi, Paul. How are you?
Fine, buddy. Nice to be with you. Big Ed is out on a little project for us. And yeah, so
he's out on assignment, so I got called in to pinch hit.
Well, I'm glad you're up there.
I'm glad I'm here, too.
I'm going to throw you a few strikes and curveballs and screwballs, but that's okay. I think you'll bat them out of the park.
So. That's it. I expect nothing less.
Anyway, thanks for joining us on this Friday. It's May the 12th. Got a lot going on. We're going to be talking in a few minutes with E.J. Antony of the Heritage Foundation. And we'll talk with E.J. about what he calls the costly and unrealistic push for electric vehicles by the White House. So stay tuned for that, just a few minutes. And the largest influx of illegal immigrants in the history of the U.S., has begun with the end of Title 42. We are going to take a look at that, so stay tuned. And a former CIA director may have confirmed the dismissal of the Hunter Biden laptop story as being nothing but political. So we're going to take a look at that as well. And in our ultimate top 10, we have a good one, the top 10 longest serving political leaders. Do you think you know who they are? Stay tuned for that towards the end of our program. So, as I say, a lot going on. And I guess we got to start off here with the end of Title 42. This is the first full day of no Title 42. The Biden administration yesterday vowed that its border strategy would succeed over time despite a record influx of illegal immigrants across the U.S.-Mexico border as it lifts pandemic-era measures and overcrowding worsens in government facilities. Now, listen to this. Illegal border crossings have now topped 10,000 per day. 10,000 per day this week. That is the highest level of all time. And if the end of Title 42 occurred at midnight, can you imagine how many people are going to be shoving their way into our country? We just, it's going to totally overwhelm us. Even the Homeland Security Director admits, Mayorkas admits, things are going to be, I don't know if he used the word chaotic, he might as well have. He released a statement that the border remains secure. What planet is Mayorkas now inhabiting? He says the border remains secure, and Border Patrol agents will resume the authorized removal of migrants. He says the border is not open. He says starting tonight, and that was yesterday when he said this, starting tonight, people who arrive at the border without using a lawful pathway will be presumed ineligible for asylum. Look, they're going to just plain release people as they come across the border. That's what they're going to do.
And you were looking for EJ? When he's ready for you, he's right here.
Yeah, no, we're not going to talk. We're going to talk with EJ after our break, my friend.
Okay. Yeah. All right. But I'm just letting you know he's on hold and waiting.
Okay. Thank you. EJ will join us right after our break, which will occur in about 5 minutes. In the meantime, here's what Mayorkas is saying. We have 24,000 Border Patrol agents and officers at the Southwest border. I wonder what they're doing. If we have that many, if you think about it, 24,000 of them across the border, wouldn't we be able to stop everybody that's coming in with that many border agents and officers? You would think. And then he says, and have surged thousands of troops and contractors and over 1,000 asylum officers to help enforce our laws. Well, then why are people pouring in like this, unauthorized? The border is not secure, and everybody knows it. But he goes on to, you know, he continues to say that things are secure. You might as well say, who are you going to believe, me or your lying eyes? I mean, this is really getting so. It's going to be leading to the downfall of Biden, I'll tell you that. He's not going to be reelected with this kind of a situation. Because nobody believes that this is doing us any good. Nobody. Even Democrats are turning back on it. So, I guess we're just going to have to watch what they do. Now, a judge has ruled that they can't just release these people with a promise that they'll show up in court. Let me see if I can find that. Where the judge basically, here it says, the statement, a federal judge yesterday or last night blocked the Biden administration from implementing a policy that would have allowed immigration officials to release migrants currently in custody. The policy was announced to clear immigration holding facilities to avoid overcrowding ahead of Title 42's expiration. Now, judge says you can't just release them. So what are they going to do? Unless they literally push back on the people trying to come in, they don't even have a place to house them if the judge says you can't release the others. So it's a real mess. It's a real mess. Let's do this. We will take our break. And when we come back, EJ Anthony is going to join us. We're going to talk about the unrealistic push for electric vehicles by the White House.
You are my candy girl, and you got me wanting you.
This is the Tantalk Radio Network.
Listen to the latest pet trends with benefits on the Pet Buzz every Saturday morning from 9 to 10 a.m. Join pet trendologist Charlotte Reed and veterinarian Dr. Michael Fleck as they talk all things pets, from animal health and wellness, money-saving tips, celebrity gossip, breaking news, and more. Their expert guests are in the know and in the now. To learn more about this unique program and its hosts, tune into the show on the Tantalk Radio Network.
Caregivers find the support they need on Connecting Caregivers Radio with Linda Burhans, the gal who cares for the caregiver. Heard every Friday from 1 to 2 p.m., Linda and her caring and knowledgeable guests will bring you education, information, and resources, as well as a shoulder for caregivers. That's Connecting Caregivers Radio with Linda Burhans, the gal who cares for the caregiver, where you can find help and hope every Friday from 1 to 2 p.m. right here on the Tantalk Radio Network.
This is the Tantalk Radio Network.
Hey, we are back on a Friday. Thank you so very much for joining us here on Freedom Works. I hope your week has been going well. We are delighted to have EJ Anthony back with us. He is a research fellow in regional economics at the Great Heritage Foundation. We're going to talk a little bit about this, what I would call a rather unrealistic push by the Biden White House to get the electric vehicles on the road, rather than allowing the free market to get them here, which I think would make much more sense. The White House is on its way to trying to get them going as quickly as possible. EJ, welcome back to Freedom Works.
Well, thank you for having me back again.
Yeah. You know, with all the chaos that's going on this morning with Title 42 and everything, we've got, I don't know what it is with this White House and with Joe Biden. It seems like they have a tin ear, you know, when it comes to doing the things that the people really want. But one of the things is this push for electric vehicles. Now, you have got an opinion piece in the Washington Times from a few days ago about what you call their expensive and unrealistic attempt to enforce these things on us. Tell us a little bit about your thoughts on this, if you would.
Well, essentially what the Biden administration is doing is precisely what you said. Instead of allowing the free market to make its own advances, instead of allowing for technological progress to bring us better products and services over time, they are trying to force everyone's hand. And to do that, they are essentially imposing incredibly unrealistic standards on auto manufacturers that will essentially force them to have all electric fleets in the near future. And essentially what that's going to do is make consumers choose vehicles that, frankly, they don't want. Because if the consumer did want those vehicles, they'd be buying them already.
Yeah.
And yet, amazingly, even after tens of thousands of dollars of subsidies on those electric vehicles and a ton of taxes on regular gas and diesel vehicles, consumers are still choosing the latter and not the former.
Yeah. In fact, you make mention of the fact, who wants to spend $61,000 these days for a car? And that is the average price of an EV. That's, 25% more than a conventional car?
Right. And, you know, I find it particularly insulting, to be quite frank. I try not to get into this kind of stuff too much. I like to stick to the numbers. But it really is insulting when the administration talks about how this is a push to help lower-income individuals. This is a push to help poor people afford electric vehicles. What poor person do you know is able to afford an electric vehicle? I mean, what poor person do you know has an electric vehicle and is going to be benefited by a charging station being put into their neighborhood? These are handouts to upper income earners and the upper middle class, pure and simple.
Yeah. I mean, you're exactly right. It's going to force more people. If you think about it, forcing people to purchase electric vehicles is only going to force poor people to try to find subways, buses, walking, hitchhiking, whatever it is, because they're not going to be able to be driving around in those things.
Right. But, you know, sure enough, if you listen to the same people who are pushing electric vehicles, they're also the ones who are pushing us to use mass transit all the time. So I think, frankly, that is all part of the plan, as it were. Not that it's some kind of grand conspiracy. I mean, they're pretty open about the fact that they want people to use mass transit and to stop using their own cars.
Yeah. They're also getting into the kitchen, of course. They're trying to eliminate, certain kinds of electric stoves or gas stoves.
Gas stoves, yeah.
Yeah, gas stoves. I mean, it's getting, and here's one of the things you mentioned. Even if Biden managed a 500% increase in electric vehicle sales by the end of the decade, he'd still fall woefully short of his goal. So they're not only costly, they don't make, they're unrealistic.
Absolutely. If you look at the raw materials that we would need to make this many electric vehicles, for instance, there is just literally no way to expand our resources, our production, our manufacturing that quickly. It's physically impossible. I mean, you're talking about things that are orders of magnitude more than what we've ever done before.
Yeah, and isn't one of the problems the lithium battery itself and having to get, what is it, the mining of copper and all of these other things that we would have to, I mean, it's almost like we don't think, we hardly think forward on what we have to do to provide these things to everybody.
Right. And we're especially not thinking about not only getting these materials, but where we're getting them from. You know, with lithium, for example, our biggest adversary, China, is very soon going to have the lithium market almost cornered, which means we will be pouring money into China's coffers the more lithium batteries we make. And I'm so glad you brought up copper, because one of the things a lot of people forget is that these electric vehicles need to be charged, which means you're charging them either at home, at work, wherever the case may be, but you're charging them somewhere that's different from where the power is being produced. You're talking about a massive expansion of the electrical grid in order to support this kind of charging infrastructure. The amount of copper alone it would take for all the new wires, all the new transmission cables that we would need would be prohibitively expensive.
So we are not going to achieve these goals. I wonder sometimes if the Democrats or the Biden administration knows that we won't, but they continue to bring these things up because they are trying to placate a certain element of the far left, the greenies, who apparently you can't argue with them because logic is not something that they want to, you know, bring into the conversation. So is this just, you know, a wink and a nod, knowing that these things really will not occur by the Biden administration?
Well, if you look at most of these green energy plans, they don't actually achieve any of the things they set out to achieve. What they really are just handouts to special interests. You know, Solyndra, I think, was the prime example of that under the Obama administration, where it's not that any of these things actually reduce emissions on net balance. It's not that any of these things are actually good for the environment or reduce carbon footprint or whatever crazy metric you want to use. The fact of the matter is, it is just a way to transfer money from the taxpayer to a Democrat donor.
We're talking with E.J. Antony. He is the research fellow for regional economics at the Great Heritage Foundation. And we're talking about a piece he wrote recently in the Washington Times, White House's expensive and unrealistic push for electric vehicles. You know, we got so many other things going on right now, and yet electric vehicles, it seems like the Biden administration, it's like, the Wizard of Oz, where, you know, disregard the man behind the curtain and all the trouble that's going on. Focus yourself over here, you know. Forget the border. Forget the cost of gasoline. Forget the economy, the inflation. Look over here. You know, here's what we're doing for you, you know. This is one of the shiny objects. You know, talking about electric vehicles, I just wonder right now, if somebody purchased an electric vehicle and they wanted to cross the United States, first of all, you'd have to figure out where all of the charging stations are. It would be kind of nightmarish, I would think. Then when you get there to charge, you got to wait, I don't know, normally a charge is what, at least a half an hour? It just, you know, there's nothing that makes it very convenient, at least at this point, to want to go running out and buying, even if you had the money, you know, to buy an electric vehicle.
Right. You know, there's actually an expose done by people at the Wall Street Journal, if I remember correctly, on precisely this issue. And even if you say, okay, let's assume charging infrastructure massively expands in the near future, and there's charging stations everywhere, there's a gas station, so I don't really have to worry about that aspect of it. You still have the problem of these batteries take a long time to recharge. It's not like gasoline, where literally in a couple of minutes, your tank is full and you're good for another 300, 400, sometimes 500 miles. And so in the expose by the Wall Street Journal, what they found was in their cross-country tour using these electric vehicles, they actually spent more time waiting for the vehicles to charge than the drivers spent sleeping during the time, you know, during the number of days it took to get across the country. In other words, the car takes more time to recharge than a human does.
Yeah. And you know, I think there, you know, most people would say, look, if we can get to electric vehicles and they become cost effective, et cetera, terrific. You know, let's do that. But if the truth is that if you allow the free market to get there, they're going to get there probably in a much better, you know, maybe even quicker, you know, realistically. They're the ones that will want, you know, all of the car companies, if they can see that electric vehicles are able to, you know, be cost effective, they're the first ones that will want to, you know, to establish the plants to build the cars. If there's a demand for these things, and I think down the road there will be, as we, you know, harness electricity a little bit better, then away we go. But to force people to, you know, abandon what's working right now for us in favor of something like this, it actually delays the success of the electric vehicle.
It certainly does. And, you know, this is the exact same thing we saw with catalytic converters, for example. When some American manufacturers, automobile manufacturers, had invested a lot of money in that technology, even though it was completely ineffective relative to other technologies available at the time when we had the first generation catalytic converters, the government still mandated them. And as soon as that happened, what did you see in terms of research and development on catalytic converters? It plummeted for exactly the reason that you're describing. Once that technology was mandated, there was no reason to go any further. There was no reason to try to reduce emissions at that point to make a cleaner or more efficient vehicle.
You know, I wonder if Biden is truly out of it or if there's a method to his madness. We talk about Biden and the Biden family and the connections to places like China and the like, and whether or not doing certain things helps them. And you brought up the fact that China will soon control about one third of the world's lithium supply. I mean, it just seems like we're playing into China's hands. And if we look and we look at the natural resources that we have in this country, including Alaska, the ability to completely take care of our energy needs on our own. And yet here we are running around the world trying to collect fuel from other countries while we're, you know, promoting electric vehicles. I mean, there's just no logic to it. It's hard to fathom that people, you know, politicians would do something like this, and yet that's what they're doing.
Right. You know, the cognitive dissonance here is, I mean, it's impossible to ignore, but it's just so palpable that you have to question whether or not the things that they say they want are what they actually want, because what they're achieving and what they say they want to achieve do not match up at all.
Yeah, that's exactly right. It's kind of scary. I mean, we look at the price of gasoline. Democrats and the Biden administration, do they think that people are excited about this? Or do they think that, paying $4 a gallon for gasoline in many places in this country, that they're winning friends and influencing people? I mean, other than the far left extremists that don't care what the cost. In fact, for them, the higher the cost of gasoline, the better it is, you know, because that way we'll abandon our, you know, we'll abandon the fossil fuels and, you know, go, you know, apparently go somewhere else, you know. I mean,
right. But see, I think that's the key there. The pain is the point. They are not concerned with making people happy in their gasoline powered cars. They're concerned with making people happy in their electric cars.
I guess so. It's really, it's just unfathomable to me. But EJ, it's a pleasure to have you on and talking about this. Thank you so very much for being with us, spending some time with us on this, and keep up the good fight.
Oh, my pleasure. Thank you for having me.
All right, sir. EJ Antony from the Heritage Foundation. All right, we're going to take a little break. And when we come back, a former CIA director may have confirmed the dismissal of the Hunter Biden laptop story being all political, and we're going to take a look.
Make the stars look like they're not shining.
This is the Tan Talk Radio Network.
Hello there, Tampa Bay. This is former NFL and college football coach Jimmy Johnson. Listen to the Kelly Kelly Show every Monday starting at 5 p.m. They can sure use the attention.
And this is former Major League Baseball player, Hall of Famer Wade Boggs. I also hope you listen to the Kelly Kelly Show every Monday starting at 5 p.m. They can darn sure use the money.
Hi there. This is marine wildlife artist and conservationist Dr. Guy Harvey. Please listen to the Kelly Kelly Show every Monday starting at 5 p.m. They need to feel worthy.
Listen to the latest pet trends with benefits on the Pet Buzz every Saturday morning from 9 to 10 a.m. Join pet trendologist Charlotte Reed and veterinarian Dr. Michael Fleck as they talk all things pets, from animal health and wellness, money-saving tips, celebrity gossip, breaking news, and more. Their expert guests are in the know and in the now. To learn more about this unique program and its hosts, tune into the show on the Tan Talk Radio Network.
This is the Tan Talk Radio Network.
Hey, we are back on a Friday on Freedom Works, and we thank you so very much for being with us. So, remember John Brennan? He's the CIA director under the Obama administration. House Judiciary Committee Chairman Jim Jordan says that the testimony that his panel heard in private from Obama CIA director John Brennan confirmed the letter signed by the 51 current and former intel officials was not on the level. Now, this had to do with these officials signing this letter saying that the laptop, Hunter Biden laptop story was Russian disinformation and was not true. Brennan sat through a four-hour interview, and according to Jordan, he further confirmed that this thing was all political. Jordan recounted his allegation that then Biden campaign advisor Anthony Blinken, who is now the Secretary of State, but he was a campaign advisor for Biden at the time, and he was the impetus behind the letter, which he said was organized in part by former CIA Deputy Director Michael Morell under Brennan, who testified before the Judiciary Committee earlier this month. So I guess what we're saying is that all of this dismissal of the laptop that Hunter Biden left for repair was an organized political attempt to hide the truth from people, and it all occurred just before the last presidential election. And the question is, if people knew that that laptop and the information on it were real, would they have elected Joe Biden president? A lot of people think that there would have been a difference, and that, you know, the race, quite frankly, was very close. So I guess we just, you know, this is just another confirmation of what seems to be going on with the Biden family and all the payoffs and all of these, what do they call them, LLVs or whatever these shell corporations are that the family, they got like 10 or 11 family members, each with their own LLV. And so all of this money that's coming from overseas is going in, it's being fed into these different shell corporations. I mean, despite the media and maybe despite the Justice Department, which is under the Biden administration, and the FBI, which is currently under the Biden administration, despite their attempts to keep it from coming and seeping to the top, it is seeping to the top. House Republicans are seeing to that, and they're going to continue on with the hearings. I mean, if you think about it, wasn't Trump impeached twice? I think he was.
Yeah, he was.
Yeah.
And he's been brought up on so many court charges, I think I've lost count.
I know. Oh, my goodness. He's the poor guy. I don't know why he's running for president.
I was just going to say the exact same thing.
Yeah, I couldn't do what he's doing, but away he goes, you know. He was on CNN the other day. Did you happen to watch or see any of that?
Unfortunately, no, I did not.
I didn't see it either. I saw outtakes from it. Apparently, he did fairly well, and CNN is now, getting beaten about the head and shoulders from a lot of people, a lot of liberals that think that they should never have allowed Trump.
Why am I not surprised? It's no matter what you put out there from a political perspective, there's always going to be some group out there that's not going to be happy with it.
Oh, you're right. Oh, immediately, half the country. You take a political stand, you got half the country against
exactly.
You.
Exactly. Right? And from where and this is just me personally, from where I sit, that's why I don't get involved in politics. It's too much of a headache. That's why I avoid it.
Yeah, I don't blame you. Boy, you would hate having to do my show every time. Listening to me talk about politics like I do.
I don't mind it. No, I don't mind it. It's like I respect everybody's point of view.
Yep.
I just don't argue it just because, and I'll be the first to admit, I don't pay attention to it, but that's my choice because half of the stuff that I think comes out of politicians' mouths, both sides, is complete BS anyway.
Yeah, you're right.
And so, in some way, shape, or form. Not all of it is, but some of it's BS. And it's just, no, because I've seen too many friends of mine lose friendships with other people over this stuff. That's why I don't get involved with it.
There's no question about it. Even families.
Oh, yeah.
I know people in families that won't talk to each other.
Exactly. And that's the reason why I stay away from getting into it.
I agree with that.
Like, if somebody brings up a point to me, I'll ask questions, but I'm not going to get into an argument over it for that reason. I don't want to lose a friendship over something
exactly
stupid.
Exactly right. And I think you're right. 100% right. And when I talk, and I like talking politics with people. In fact, I kind of enjoy talking politics with people I disagree with or don't agree with me. But if it gets to a point where you can't talk to each other and you're virtually just dissing the other, then, you know, it's not worth it. And if you can't, what's the word? If you can't compartmentalize it.
There you go. That's a good word for it.
If you can compartmentalize it, you can actually have an enjoyable, in my opinion, and interesting conversation. And then, you know, but the rules are, hey, listen, we're going into this little room here. We're going to talk it. Then we're going to come out. We're going to still love each other like we did before we went in. Let's agree on that. Right.
Right. I mean, there's other shows that we even have here on this network that have political tones to it. And I'll listen to it, and I'll listen to their opinions. I'll ask questions the same way I'm going back and forth with you now.
Right.
And
you should.
Yeah.
I think.
I want to try to educate myself to a degree. I may not agree with it. And like I said, I have my takes, too, on everything that goes on. It's just sometimes it's probably the less you talk, the better.
It's always better.
Yeah.
That's why God gave us two ears and only one mouth.
Exactly. And, like, I have my opinions on what's going on politically from what I catch. I just choose to keep it to myself so that way it doesn't set off a firestorm with getting bombarded from people on the other side.
Yeah, I agree with you. Absolutely agree.
I just wish more people would do that. Like, everybody's entitled to opinions and everybody's allowed to express them. We just need to calm down with getting into arguments over it.
Right, you are. Yeah, absolutely. You touched on this thing with Trump and the town hall and CNN. And I happen to have a story about that. The question of whether or not it hurt CNN. And there is a women's advocacy group. It's called Ultraviolet. I like that name, Ultraviolet. Anyway, they went after CNN for having Trump on. And now they're calling for the firing of the CEO of CNN for having him on.
Why?
His name is Chris Licht. Let's see here. I'll find out why. Says here, this is apparently Ultraviolet's blasting the network, demanding that it fire Licht as a way to show accountability. Quote, CNN's town hall was a disaster. CNN knew Donald Trump would lie about the 2020 election and make reckless and untrue claims about everything from January 6th to abortion. He even mocked E. Jean Carroll the day after a federal court convicted him of defamation and sexual assault against her. CNN not only allowed Trump to do so, they enabled him. The network must take accountability by firing CEO Chris Licht, who knowingly broadcast lies and conspiracies on national television. Now, some of the, as I say, I didn't see it in its entirety, but I saw some of the outtakes. And the CNN female correspondent really went after him. She would ask the questions. It was a town hall. I believe it was in New Hampshire. And they had Republican primary voters that were in the audience. So they would tend to be, you know, favor Republicans, but that didn't mean they favored Trump. But Trump got a lot of applause, and that poor CNN lady, she would keep peppering him with questions and kind of cutting into his responses. You know? She was kind of really, really aggressive. And at one point, he said, "You're a very nasty person." And like only Trump can say.
Oh, yeah.
You know? And apparently that generated some applause and laughter in the audience there. But let's see here. A statement, I guess, from CNN. Unless something significantly changes, Donald Trump will be the Republican presidential candidate. We need to figure out how the free press can safeguard our democracy. Oh, I guess this is ultraviolet still. We need to figure out how the free press can safeguard our democracy with an unrepentant demagogue on the ballot.
A what?
He's an unrepentant demagogue.
Ah, okay.
That's what they've called him.
That's a phrase. I've never heard that before.
As evidenced by the embarrassing display on CNN, if the network has any ethics left, they will fire Chris Licht immediately. So there you go. Although, you know what? CNN had a big audience to watch it. Apparently about 3 million people were watching it, which is more than they ever get.
And that's saying something. That's saying something, considering it's CNN, who's considered by most, I think, to be a major news network.
Oh, they are.
Right.
CNN and, you know, in cable, they are. They've been around for years.
Yeah.
Fox News is dominating cable news right now, but CNN and MSNBC, you know, and of course the regular networks, ABC, CBS,
NBC.
NBC, all of them, yeah.
Fox.
Yeah, the thing about Fox is they're sort of like, there are other conservative network cable networks now, but Fox for a long time was all by itself as a conservative voice, you know. But now you've got a Newsmax and what is it? One America News, I think it's called, OAN. So there's some others.
Yeah, I'm not sure. I think you're onto something, but I'm not sure, honestly.
Yeah. I'm not sure if I'm ever on anything, but we just continue on no matter how.
Exactly.
All right. Speaking about endorsements, by the way, Ron DeSantis has been endorsed by two high-profile Iowa Republicans. Now, Donald Trump and Ron DeSantis are both residents of Florida, and it looks like the governor is going to get into the race, although he hasn't officially announced yet. And there's been all this talk about all of these Florida politicians that are backing Trump. And then when you, what's the word, when you scroll down deeper into it, apparently a lot of these Republican politicians that are backing Trump in Florida are worried that they will be primaried by Trump. In other words, Trump will push for somebody else running against them in the Republican primary the next time they're up for election. Whether that's true or not, I'm not sure. But two high-profile Iowa Republicans, the president of the Iowa Senate, Amy Sinclair, and the House Majority Leader in Iowa, Matt Winchell, or Winchittle, are endorsing DeSantis. DeSantis is going to be holding a pair of events this weekend in the Sioux Center and Cedar Rapids, Iowa. Actually, tomorrow he's going to be there. I mean, it sure looks like DeSantis is running. Why would he be running around the country doing all of these things? Why would he go to Iowa? He's running. Now, the thing about Florida is that he has to give up his governorship as soon as he announces he's running for president. And I think there's a female lieutenant governor, I can't think of her name, that would take over for him. But these two people are endorsing DeSantis, and that's going to make it very interesting. In the interview, the woman that I mentioned, Amy Sinclair, said DeSantis stands, quote, head and shoulders above the rest of the field, and called the choice an easy endorsement for me. She cited his work on lowering taxes, emphasizing parental rights, easing regulations, saying that those values mirror the work that she's doing in the Iowa legislature and in her district. So there you go. All right. I think we will take our final break here. And when we come back, among other things, we are going to give you our top 10, which is the top 10 longest serving political leaders.
This is the Tantalk Radio Network. Are you a writer, inventor? Do you have questions about your intellectual property rights? Well, tune in every Tuesday and Thursday morning at 11 o'clock for Joy on Paper. Once a month, I will have a special guest, the writer's legal eagle, Bill Larson of Larson & Larson, who can answer your questions. Protect your valuable work. Email me your questions to patsy.radio@gmail.com and then listen in every Tuesday and Thursday at 11 a.m. right here on Tampa Bay's Tan Talk Radio Network. That's patsy.radio@gmail.com.
Hey, you new to the area or just want to know about the best hidden gems and upcoming events? Stay tuned. Be Local Buzz with Devin takes you to these places, introduces you to the best businesses, and tells you about upcoming buzz. Preset your radio to Tan Talk 1340 AM or 106.1 FM every Thursday from 4 to 5. That is the Be Local Buzz with Devin on Tan Talk 1340 AM and 106 FM every Thursday from 4 to 5. Looking forward to speaking with you.
This is the Tan Talk Radio Network.
Hey, we are back. Final segment, Freedom Works, here on a Friday. Thank you so very much for joining us this morning. And by the way, Freedom Works is on Mondays, Wednesdays, and Fridays, 10 to 11 a.m. Eastern Time on the fantabulous Tan Talk Radio Network, and we thank you when you can listen to us live. However, we have our, thanks to Big Ed Davis, we have all of our programs on podcast as well. So if you miss a show and you're busy or you want to hear it again, all you have to do is go to our website, which is ourfreedomworks.com, O-U-R, ourfreedomworks.com. If you look at the top, you'll see the podcast button. Just click on it. It'll open up, and there you see all of our shows, most recent show at the top. You'll see who the guest will be. You'll see our top 10. And you can listen at your leisure, ourfreedomworks.com. Well, I think we got one of our buddies on the line with us. He just couldn't hold back. He's been very busy recently. Andrew the Master Barber. Andrew, how are you?
Wonderful, Paul. But, you know, I'm out here. I'm doing some work, and I'm listening to your show, but I got to correct you about something.
Hey, you're multitasking. Go ahead. Go ahead and correct me.
You said that if Ron DeSantis now decides he wants to be president, he has to give up the governorship. You are wrong.
I am.
He had the legislature passed that he can run for president and keep his job.
When did he get that passed?
I believe it was last week.
I don't think it's been passed yet. I may be wrong. I'm not surprised that he wants that done.
Of course. And that's one thing that people are a little bit upset about.
You know what? While you're talking with me, and I'm glad you called, maybe I can Google this and see if he did get it passed. I didn't know he passed it.
Yeah. I thought it went right through the legislature. It flew right through.
Wow. Okay. Well, then I may be corrected here. I thought he still has to give up his...
No.
His governorship. Okay.
Mm-mm.
Yeah. Yeah. You don't want to make a little side bet on that it's passed. No. We won't do that. So anyway, let's assume that it is passed. So he can go ahead and continue on as governor. He's got to be making the announcement fairly soon, don't you think?
Oh, definitely. I'd say within the next couple of weeks.
At least.
Yes, easily.
I thought by the end of the legislature, and I think the Florida legislature has ended its term.
That's right.
Yeah. So any day now, he might just announce. I mean, he's going to be in Iowa. We were just talking
Isn't Trump having a rally in Iowa Saturday himself?
He may. That may
he
be
is.
True. He is? Okay.
He is. It's on. They're going to have it. They're going to air it on Newsmax at 7 o'clock.
Okay. Now, everybody should know that Andrew is a very good friend of the DeSantis family. He knows his father very, very well. I've had the opportunity and the pleasure of meeting Ron Sr. He just strolls into the the barbershop on a regular basis and sits and chats, and he's the nicest guy in the world and all of that. So... I know, Andrew, that you have mixed feelings because you've been a Trump supporter.
It's confusion. Confusion.
That's what I was going to say. So have you made up your mind? I mean,
Paul, I kind of have.
Okay.
I kind of have. I mean, I'm still a Trump fan.
Okay. Yeah. You know, I'm not being honest about it.
I mean, I still believe in the guy. Now, I believe that if Trump, for some reason, with all these indictments and things, can't run, then it'd be great for Ron to step in.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, we got to have a backup plan.
Yeah.
But, you know, everybody, he can't win. No, that's baloney. I mean, I see what's going on. And you watch his rally tomorrow night. I mean, he's going to rock the house.
Well, he always does. Did you watch any of that CNN?
I watched every minute of it.
How did you feel about the way he came off on it?
I think he did outstanding. I think the chick thought she was going to do, what's her name, Megyn Kelly? Remember when Megyn Kelly got her that one night? Yeah, I think she thought she was going to outdo her. And boy, she's lucky she had a white suit on to surrender.
How do you feel about some of the so-called talking heads on CNN after that was held? Trying to say that every other sentence out of Trump's mouth was not true.
That was supposed to be an hour and a half. They cut it short to an hour and 7 minutes because they knew Trump was destroying them. Yes, you didn't know that.
I didn't, but from what I saw, and I didn't see the thing live, I saw a little outtakes. He handled himself extremely well.
Mm-hmm.
He knocked a few of them right out of the park, and she kept trying to interrupt him, and supposedly trying to correct him. So rather than being an interviewer, she was more of a debater.
She thought.
Or so she thought, correct.
She thought, man. It makes me laugh because I sat there and all I said was, this chick is in the ringer at Mike Tyson and doesn't realize it. You know?
Yeah, I do know. You know,
but they all think they're going to be a star and get him, man. The guy is the new untouchable.
He's as sharp as ever. We were talking, Matt and I, here before he came on about, why would somebody go through all of the slapping around that he's getting and would still want to get back up, you know?
Well, it's like I tell everybody. I says, if any one of us had his money, we'd be out on our 100-foot yacht in the Gulf of Mexico enjoying life, okay?
Yep.
This man loves the country. He is not a politician, and I really believe his bucket list is to save this country, and I believe the man up above has got his thumb on him.
The latest poll I saw has him leading Biden by about 7 points.
It's probably leading him by 27 points. But you think they're going to tell you? Listen, once this train of immigrants, illegals, all come in the country, now look at what he's doing.
Yeah.
Look at what he do. You think the people are going to put up with this, Paul? I'm really surprised that all the armed American citizens aren't meeting down by that border, just standing there with all their, what do they call them, assault rifles.
Yeah.
Okay.
You know, if I was DeSantis, maybe I would step back and I'd say, you know what? I think I'll let Trump, because he's probably going to win. I'll let Trump run again, and I'll wait 4 years.
That's right.
And that way we would keep DeSantis in his job as
governor
of Florida.
He's doing a great, great job. Don't get me wrong. But Donald Trump loves this country, my friend.
Yeah.
And I really believe that man that is determined as he is right now, there's no stopping him. And I really feel sorry for anybody that gets in his way.
Yeah, you may be right about that. He certainly has all of the energy of a guy half his age. There's just no question. Paul,
I've never seen such a determined man in my life.
Yeah.
And when you're that determined, you're not going to lose, buddy.
I'm so glad you called us, and I want to make it a regular thing once everything settles down.
It'll happen, buddy.
Yeah,
hopefully in another month, because the wife is walking around on her own, and things are... She's calming down a bit, buddy.
He has a wonderful wife, Nicole.
She's a sweetheart.
She keeps him in line. Thanks so much, Andrew.
You got it, buddy. Have a good weekend.
And the same. Andrew, the master barber. All right. We are going to now do our top 10, Matt. And here's how we do that.
All right, let's do this.
You have to go over to the drums. Which
yeah, I got everything set up right here.
And I understand you're a decent drummer.
Yeah, so I am.
So what we'll do is I will do a countdown. I'll start at 10, and we'll go all the way to 1. And when I say 10, you'll roll the drum, and I'll give you the answer to it. Now, what we're doing is we're doing the top 10 longest-serving political leaders. And I want to make a note that this does not include queens and kings, because technically they might not have been the political leaders, even though they were the royalty.
Yeah. So are we limiting this to just North America, like the U.S., Canada, Mexico, or is it
the world?
Okay.
The world.
Just wanted to make sure we clarify that.
All right, you ready? Drumsticks in hand. Here we go. Number 10. Number 10 is Hun Sen. Good old Hun Sen. I know, Matt, you remember him well. Hun Sen was the prime minister of Cambodia from 1985 to 2010. He served for 25 years and 2 months, all right? Number 9. Another guy that Matt was friends with, Denis Sassou-Nguesso. Remember him?
Oh, yeah. He's an old friend of mine. He used to live down the block from me.
Well, at one time, he was the president of the Congo Republic. Before going and living on down the block, he served from 1979 to 2007, 25 years and 11 months. Number 8, Paul, and I'm going to hope I pronounce it right, Biya, B-I-Y-A, president of Cameroon. He served for 27 years and 4 months, from 1982 to 2009. Number 7. Now, this guy I really do know. The others, to be honest with you, so far I didn't know. Hosni Mubarak. He was president of Egypt from 1981 to 2009. He served 28 years and 5 months. Number 6. Another guy I remember, Robert Mugabe. He was the prime minister of Zimbabwe. He served 30 years in that capacity. From 1987 to 2017. Number 5, the president of Angola, José Eduardo dos Santos. He served for 30 years and 6 months from 1979 to 2010. Number 4, Teodoro Mbasso, Teodoro Mbasogo, M-B-A-S-O-G-O. He was the king of Equatorial Guinea. He served for 30 years and 7 months from 1979 to 2010. Number 3, Ali Abdullah Saleh, president of North Yemen. He served 31 years, 8 months from 78 to 2010. Number 2, Muammar Gaddafi. Remember him, the president of Libya?
I do.
Yeah, I do too. Do you know he served for 40 years and 6 months?
Wow.
Yeah, from 1969 to 2010. They executed him.
So they did.
Yeah, they did. All right. Who do you think? It's somebody you know very well. I know you know him. Who do you think's number one?
From North America.
Not from North America. You want me to give you a hint?
I think it may be Cuban.
Yes. Yeah. Wow. Very good. Fidel Castro. You were right.
That's what I thought. As soon as you didn't say North American, I figured it had to be Castro.
Very good. He served for 49 years. Did you know that? He took over in 1959, and he served till 2008. And then his brother served for a couple of more years after that. So there you go. All right. Thank you so very much for being with us here on Freedom Works. We will be back on Monday.
All right.
Be safe, drive carefully, and remember, freedom works.
Here's a little song I wrote. You might want to sing it note for note. Don't worry, be happy. In every life we have some trouble, but when you worry you make it.